Hey everyone, welcome back to the Zelda Informer Podcast, episode number 16. Obviously, I'm back after a one-week hiatus. Thank you, Alfred, for really picking up the pieces last week and throwing together an awesome short podcast.
I completely forgot the latter half where we're supposed to talk about our favorite part of the week.
It's okay. It was the first podcast you had to run without any help. So
that's true.
You did a really good job throwing it together with very short notice. I had some personal stuff going on, but I don't want to say the personal stuff necessarily cleaned up, but I've found my passion, my dedication again to get this going. So this week, things are going to be a little bit different. We're going to start with our fan topics first, because I don't have any topic Zelda-wise that I want to talk about this week. They could have become Zelda-wise topics, but they're not based around Zelda. So I always like to start off the Zelda Informer Podcast with Zelda topics, so that's why we're going straight to our fan topics this week, and all of them come from Facebook, and I apologize to everyone who might have tried to get us in other places. I just didn't have time today, but I will double check our YouTube, our email, and all this other stuff, and make sure if you submitted anything there that it will be there next week. So you have all the dibs right now in the world if I didn't get to your topic this week through any other method. So starting right off, Charlie.
Let's
May.
Introduce our guests first.
Oh
Nate.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
We have two people on the podcast that aren't
no,
us.
No, we don't have anybody else on the podcast. No, that's right. So see, this is what happens. I take 1 week off and I forget how to host.
That's what you've got me here for.
Yes. So obviously, you've heard Alfred talking. He's the co-host, picks me up when I'm making mistakes like this. And then we also have Mr. Daniel.
Oh, hello.
Care to explain what you do at Zelda Informer?
Hey, I'm new. But, yeah, basically I make some of the videos that you guys see on the YouTube channel. So,
yeah, sorry about your most recent video.
Oh, well,
that wasn't supposed to go live yet.
Oh, whoops.
That's why it hasn't been posted to the site yet, because like, I have different things I have to... Haven't linked the videos at the end. I haven't changed the thumbnail. Anyways, that's what I get for uploading it in the middle of the night and forgetting to set it to private.
Oops.
That's okay. It hasn't been to our site where a majority of our viewership comes from.
So far, the comments are pretty positive, though. People seem to like it, so.
Yeah, so yeah, he provides some extra video content. It's been great stuff. Yeah, cool. Speaking of video content, we have one of my favorite YouTubers on the cast, Mr. McIntyre.
Oh, thank
from
you.
From McIntyre Productions.
He's back again.
Thanks. Hey, I'm McIntyre Productions. Some people call me Andy. What I typically do on the channel is I'm very well known to doing Zelda theories. I'm actually working on one right now, actually. It should be up Friday, and when I say Friday, it'll probably be up on Saturday. But yeah,
isn't that how it always goes?
Yeah, definitely. Well, if you like what you're hearing, then I post all that stuff up on my YouTube channel, McIntyre Productions. If you like that, then hey, I'm here for you.
Yep, and I love it, and part of it's because you just have the best talking voice, man.
That's like butter. So smooth.
So yep. Smooth. Thank you. So now we'll get into the topics.
There you go.
Week.
Now we're ready. Yeah.
So Charlie Meg from our Facebook page said, if you put the Zelda series in order from Skyward Sword, where do the timelines split? Which, if this feels like a really obvious question. What causes it, and is there going to be a game about Ganon's side? So, this question is really weird.
Yeah.
There's only one spot in the whole timeline that any split occurs right now. It's Ocarina of Time. Mm-hmm. It's all explained in Hyrule Historia. So, Charlie, in case you aren't aware, I'll just give the basic rundown. Skyward Sword, there's some time-traveling stuff. You beat the game. Zelda feels bad that you skipped your childhood, so she sends you back in time.
In Ocarina of Time, not Skyward Sword.
Yeah, I'm sorry. In Ocarina of Time, yeah. So she sends you back in time to relive your childhood. And while you go back in time, you go to warn Zelda, and then the events that happened when you first played through Ocarina of Time end up not happening. So it creates two timelines. Then there's a third timeline split that was announced with Hyrule Historia, and that is where Link's going to fight Ganon, trying to defeat him, and he ends up failing. It's inferred that he dies, and that creates the third split where Ganon ends up winning. And that's where most of the old games take place. And then Link to the Past, Zelda 2, Link Between Worlds is over there too. So there are some newer games, but that's where all of the currently known splits come from. However, obviously the fact that there's a split created off of death kind of means there's infinite possibilities of splits with the series, which Nintendo might have done on purpose because they don't really want to ever be held back.
By story.
Lore-wise. They had a really cool story reason to do something, but they're like, oh, we can't because, like, that character already died or this happened or that. They can come up with infinite excuses now to split it off.
It's basically like the multiverse in DC Comics and Marvel now. They're like, oh, yeah. Well, we got this character in this timeline, so we can keep him going.
Except they reset their universe a lot.
All the time. all the time.
Zelda has yet to do that.
Knock on
wood. It might get to that point. That might be a topic for another day. In terms of, is there going to be a game about Ganon's side? I have no idea. I think the closest
we got to that was Ganondorf's story mode in Hyrule Warriors, but otherwise, I guess not. Mm-hmm. Or probably not.
Yeah, and Hyrule Warriors, you know, is a spin-off game, technically not canon, so none of that. It
you mean
matters.
You don't ship Lona and Link like I do, Nate? It's a totally canon couple.
Oh boy.
Well, like,
no, I do not.
I mean, I guess it's possible since Nintendo always likes to do really, really innovative stuff, at least when it comes towards a gameplay design. But in terms of an actual game where Ganondorf is like the lead, I'm not particularly sure. Like, that seems kind of out there in all honesty, but maybe it's going to come sooner than we think.
Yeah, the only thing I can point to is, again, Miyamoto, back during E3 this year, stated a very interesting quote about side games. I don't have the quote right in front of me. I did bring it up in a prior podcast episode. Mm-hmm. But he essentially said that they've been looking into side games and that they're not opposed to doing side games for Zelda. And that one particular idea they had for a side game had to do with Sheik, which is, you know, one of the more obvious things because fans have been asking what happened in those 7 years. For a long time, and seeing it through the eyes of Sheik, aka Princess Zelda. Sorry, spoiler warning.
I'd totally play that game though. It'd be a wicked game.
It just totally blew anyone's mind who has not played Ocarina.
Oh, you got to put a spoiler warning.
Warriors.
You got to put a spoiler warning before I say it. I know, not after. So it's not. I'm sorry. I tend not to spoiler warn anything that's over 10 years old.
Oh, yeah. As I said in my video, actually. It's like, guys, 20 years later.
So, yeah, I don't really. It's possible, you know, if they do the Sheik thing, obviously that would be kind of like a Princess Zelda story. They could easily do a Ganon one if they want. And obviously, what happens in the downfall timeline, like when Link dies, that would be a really cool thing to follow. And that's just one possibility. Obviously, you could really pick any game. You could pick Twilight Princess, you could pick A Link to the Past. There's so many different games you could pick and just play Ganondorf's side of things and see what he's seeing, his perspective. And I always thought that would be really cool in the Wind Waker, given what we know of his perspective. Isn't exactly wholly evil, and it'd be really cool to see how he got to that point. So I always thought it would be cool, but we don't know. Until a side game that's not like a Hyrule Warriors, like a canon story-based side game, happens. It's hard for me to say it's going to happen for Ganon. Granted, Tingle ended up having his own series, so
it wasn't really like sold widely though. So it wasn't like
it did okay in Japan to have a trilogy.
In Japan.
Well, that's the only place that likes him besides me.
Hey.
Tingle kind of strikes me as like a horror character, like someone you would see.
Oh, you're gonna diss my hero like that? Oh man.
But
seriously, I'm 30. Someday I'm going to put on some spandex and pretend I'm a kid again. It's just going to happen. Every day. I just don't know the spandex part. That's the only thing. I hope that kind of answers things for you, Charlie. Obviously, we have no idea if there's ever going to be a game, but the splits are clearly explained. So if you didn't know that,
they're explained.
They're explained, yeah. There's a lot of disagreement that, especially with the third split, the downfall timeline. But you could get in all those debates out there with lots and lots of Zelda fans, but that's where the splits happen. Skyward Sword really has nothing to do with the splits yet, unless there's a new split that we don't know about.
Yeah.
Because there, I think there was a theory out there, I can't remember which YouTuber it was by, about a potential for this game, Breath of the Wild, the new one coming out next year, potentially splitting off into a separate timeline from Skyward Sword. But we'll see. The next fan topic we have comes from David Johnston. Again, all of these come from our Facebook page. Which Zelda game, in your opinion, has the most well-written characters?
Majora's Mask.
Majora's Mask. Or Skyward Sword as well.
Yeah, but I still say Majora's Mask first. Oh. I know Nate really likes Skyward Sword, and the characters in that game are very well-written. But, like, there's...
At the same time, you have Midna from Twilight Princess.
Yeah, but there's more, like, more characters that are given depth in Majora's Mask.
Oh, totally.
Like each side character is given a struggle, is given, they're given a backstory, and how, I think I'm talking about this in whatever editorial I'm writing right now, not currently, but, you know, about how each character isn't necessarily affecting the story, but they're being affected by the story, and we're being shown how the events of Majora's Mask are affecting them personally, like the Cafe and Anju storyline. So it has very well-written characters with real emotions and real struggles. And yeah, there's pretty well-written characters in Skyward Sword, but if you really think about that, that's just a lot of tropey characters. Like,
ooh,
you've got,
he brought it up.
You've got Groose, who's a tropey character, who, I'll admit, has a very good character development. But he's very tropey.
Pompadour.
Yeah.
That's all that's needed.
Gear him.
Grooseland, baby.
It's still very well written, just not as well written as Majora's Mask, in my factual opinion.
No, I agree with you. I just made a video about it, so you can hear my opinion there. But no, Majora's Mask is really, it's also very, like, all the characters are super emotional too. Like, you get more attached to these weird side characters than you do some of the main characters in most other games, in my opinion.
I think it's hard to say any other game but Majora's Mask, and that's not because, you know, the writing, I think, overall has at times been better for specific characters. Like, I think Ganon's writing in The Wind Waker might be the epitome of villain writing that I have seen in the Zelda series.
Well, he was slightly sympathetic in that game too. He wasn't.
Yeah.
Like,
well, yeah. It was obviously a different take on him as well. But it's like the most we've actually seen from that character beyond. He's just the evil guy who wants to destroy the world. Yeah. You know, obviously there's the theories about trying to protect his people and yada yada yada. But
yeah, like,
too much.
I would suppose, like, my favorite written character, now that I really think about it, would have to be Colin in Twilight Princess. Basically, ooh, like, in the beginning of, let's say, the game, he's always getting picked on by the other kids and such, and always looks up to Link. And then basically around the Kakariko portion, where, you know, the King Bulblin comes in and just is going to ran over one of the girls. I forgot what her name was. But then, like, he was about to run away, and he didn't. And I love that show, don't tell kind of mechanic. He was going to run away like all the others, but then he stopped and then wondered, oh, what would Link would do? Then he went back and actually saved the girl, but he got captured instead. And then,
sure.
And then basically he was saying that he wanted to be strong like Link. And that really, like, from an emotional level, that really, really, like, hit you. And I think that's one of my high points in Twilight Princess's writing.
I could totally agree with that.
Yeah.
And that's what's tough about this question is because there's a lot of individual characters that Nintendo has written very, very well. But when we're talking about, you know, because he says, which is all the game, like, I think of the whole game, it's hard for me to say anything but Majora's Mask because Majora's Mask is the only game so far in the series, in my opinion at least, where the characters are what make the world matter. All the other games, you're just told, go save this land, go save your sister, go save Zelda. You know, the characters are there, but they're not necessarily relevant. They're not really driving you to want to save the world. Because, you know, if you think at the beginning of Majora's Mask, everything you're doing is for a selfish reason. You, Skull Kid came, jacked your stuff, put a curse on you, and all you're really trying to do is just get back to where you were with Epona and no curse. Like, that's the basis for you trying to do anything in Majora's Mask. But then something happens when you just start talking to anyone. Even if you don't talk to the characters in Clock Town, just the progression of the characters' speeches throughout the dungeons. It's kind of set up in this way where it makes you care about the people. And it starts being where Termina isn't really a land, per se. It's not like a piece of land that you're just protecting from getting destroyed. It's people that you're protecting from getting destroyed. It's the only game in the series that makes me feel like these characters matter. That they have lives. That they care about what's going on in the world. That they're affected by the world around them. And a lot of other games aren't like that. Even in like Twilight Princess, as amazing as Colin is, as amazing as I think Midna is in that game, I even like Zan's progression up until, you know, spoiler warning, you know, Ganondorf kind of jacks the story. That's the only thing I don't like about Zan's progression. But then you go to Castletown, and you just have all these irrelevant characters you can't even interact with all over the place. Like, it just kills the experience for me. Like, why do I care about these people who are just there to clutter? No one gives a crap. No one's affected by anything. Besides, you know, obviously the resistance is there. But, you know, again, those are a few characters out of the hundreds I'm seeing on my screen that I can't even interact with.
Well, the resistance characters really aren't fleshed out either.
And there's issues with them, too. Yeah.
And, like
they're not examples of good.
They're interesting characters.
Yeah.
But I want more from them.
Yeah. They're kind of like, we had this really great idea, but they never fleshed it out.
Mm-hmm.
That's what those characters kind of felt like to me. So, it's hard for me. Majora's Mask, just as a collective, you know, there's been better written individual characters, but there hasn't been a better world built around those characters. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what Majora's Mask did with that. I mean, even if you look at it, to this day, all character interactions are basically compared to Majora's Mask. And there's a reason for that. You know, a lot of the Wind Waker's best interactions with characters are stuff that started in Majora's Mask. Just the basis of how the stories are told. How those characters, you know, grow up and inspire. Like, you know, in Skyward Sword, I really love how they do the story and how they handle the characters. But again, it's really only in Skyloft.
Mm-hmm.
And
there really aren't any other characters.
Well, like there are other characters, but they're not.
Well, they don't
you
matter.
Really, like you have the traveling Goron and stuff. That like okay, cool, but he doesn't seem to be negatively impacted by anything. So, you know, whatever. He's just traveling, making some maps. Like okay, cool. You know, you have the robots, and there's a lot of like interesting things where you want to learn some history of the land, but there's nothing that makes you outside of maybe the spirits or the dragons and stuff. Maybe they make you kind of wonder a little bit more, but again, those are minor moments. When in Majora's Mask, every moment feels like it impacts people. That is how the game is built. It's not just how the characters were written; it's how they're built around a time mechanic. So there's a lot more elements to that that might never again exist in a Zelda game, because I don't think any Zelda game is going to try to put a specific limit on the entire game like that. because it is a lot easier to build characters out in a way. Where they just do that same thing for 72 straight hours in the game, and that's it. You know, versus having a big open world like Breath of the Wild, where you could potentially have years of, you know, people just spending years in-game traveling around and having those characters have something going on different every single day for years.
They do it in Animal Crossing, just saying.
Yeah, well, that's a little more simplistic.
But I think with that's Animal Crossing, that's like the whole point of Animal Crossing, right? That's not really the whole point of Zelda. So if you could have in Zelda, it's great, right? Like Majora's Mask, but yeah.
Yeah, so that's why in other games we have seen Majora's Mask like side quests, Majora's Mask like characters, where they have relationships and things are going on and you're trying to help them out. And I think we're going to get a lot of that in Breath of the Wild. I think a lot of the villages themselves that we end up discovering are going to be built around that Majora's Mask-like concept, a really tight-knit community that's affected by the world around them, and it's going to make you want to do more than just go defeat the bad guy. That's at least
what I'm getting.
I have no idea. Probably not.
Will it be infinite? Will we be able to see other players in the game?
Oh boy.
Yes.
You promise?
Definitely.
Okay.
It's good. Very, very unlikely. The world is so big.
Okay.
But Yes.
The open air world with procedurally generated trees.
Oh my gosh. Anyways, so yeah, I hope it gave you some stuff to think about, David. Obviously, a lot of big heavy lean towards Majora's Mask, but we brought up some other games that have you know individual really great characters. So yeah, pretty much everything I feel like from Majora's Mask on, there's an example in the game of, you know, a handful of characters that have done really, really well, the story. Chris Forbes, he says, with Wind Waker HD, we saw the addition of Tingle Bottles, which added limited social interaction between players online. Would you like to see Breath of the Wild use a similar method for interaction, and how could it help or hinder the game?
So I have, I instantly think of Dark Souls little, messages on the ground. Like, that's just what pops into my head right away. Like,
well, that's basically what Tingle Bottles are.
Yeah, they're pretty much the same thing. I just imagine them being like, you know, right before you go into a dungeon, it's like, well, here, like, be prepared for this, this, or this whenever you go into the dungeon. Which, you know, you could probably turn on or off to make the game easier or difficult. I don't think it's going to be nearly as difficult as a Dark Souls game. But that's...
Well, there's also things... what is it? I think Zombie U, one of the first games for the Wii U, it had areas where people could put messages on the walls.
Yeah.
That was really cool. There's other games... The Splatoon has that in some ways in the main town. Actually, it has it in some of the maps, too. Yeah. Where some Miiverse stuff comes up on the walls.
I don't think we're going to see anything like multiplayer. You know, you're going to be able to run it to... in Hyrule Warriors, where you have like the ghost characters that you can get online that come into the game that you can not that kind of interaction. I'm thinking, like we said, more along the lines of the Dark Souls messages on the ground or Tingle Bottles or what have you. And that's the only thing that I could think really that Nintendo would do.
I don't think we're gonna get any of that, to be honest.
Well, I'm just to answer the
question.
Yeah,
I know. Because, he says, you know, would you like to see Breath of the Wild use some of the method? Not really. And now, that's not to say I dislike Tingle Bottles. I am mad that that's how they replaced the Tingle Tuner. Like, they did have this content, you know, already in the game, and then they, with a game that already has a gamepad that you should just be able to hand off to a friend so they could drop bombs. Like, it's the one time that the Tingle Tuner might have actually got played with, and they just decided to be lazy and cut it out and replace it with Tingle Bottles. Probably to help push Miiverse at the time or something. I don't know. I thought that the Tingle Bottles themselves were kind of interesting, even though, you know, most of the Tingle Bottles were useless. You know, they come from your friends or floating around. It is kind of cool, you know, if you have a buddy that you and him are kind of going back and forth, hiding, you know, you don't really hide them because you don't control what the Tingle Bottles are. But, you know, going back and forth trying to find all of each other's messages, you know, and trying to put them together. Like, I had a buddy who I must have made, I don't know how many Tingle Bottles, but he found every single one of them. It was over 50 of them. And he put together basically what my next editorial was going to be at Zelda Informer. I had it all spread out through the game. So anyone who was friends with me on my Wii U account, they could have potentially gotten my entire editorial before it ever went live.
Wow.
So it was kind of just a cool thing I was kind of throwing out there. Seeing if anybody picked it up, and someone actually did. They found every single bottle and put it together. They also found, typos in it, but I was retyping my entire editorial on the Wii U gamepad, so give me a break. anyways, using the limitations of the Tingle Bottle. So, I thought there was some really cool interactions that you could do with it, kind of like that. But it just Breath of the Wild doesn't feel like a game that needs that. It's a game built on all this explorative stuff, and I feel like there could be some confusion. If I see something somewhere, a symbol or a message, that might be like, yeah, is that from another player or is that from the game? Because this world is huge. This world is really about being by yourself again. You know, obviously you're always Link, but it doesn't appear you have a companion in this game. It doesn't appear you rely upon anything but yourself. And if you start throwing multiplayer Tingle Bottles into the mix, you know, Tingle Bottle-like things or messages on walls, it kind of breaks that little immersion you have with that world. In kind of a weird way, this is just my overall opinion with Breath of the Wild. It almost feels like Breath of the Wild is like the ultimate like Zelda game. And multiplayer, as much as I enjoy the multiplayer Zelda games, as much as I enjoy the Tingle Battles, that's not really what the core of Zelda is about. So for them to like build this game that I think is really establishing or reestablishing the core of Zelda, it doesn't need it. Plus, I think it would be really difficult for them because they're going to have a split player base between the Wii U and NX as well. So that might be difficult for them to even try to do something like that.
Well, I mean, as long as it's the Miiverse, it wouldn't be a problem.
Yeah, if it's a Miiverse, because I don't think Miiverse is going anywhere. They might rebrand it. Maybe they won't. I mean, Miis might not be going anywhere at all, so maybe they won't. Yeah, I know they're trying to get away from the Wii branding, but who knows? They might not redo it. But, yeah. Daniel and McIntyre, you guys have been kind of silent. Got any thoughts?
Well, I was going to say something, and then you said it. I was just going to say, if they did, like, a Tingle Bottle sort of thing, I'd probably just turn it off, because in other games where I've had, like, Miiverse messages, like, even just, like, platformers, like playing Super Mario Maker, or, hell, even, like, Yoshi's Woolly World, I tend to ignore them, because they are like, they, like, spoil it, basically, you know? And I can't discover these things for myself, so I just, like, ignore them or turn them off completely. Yeah, and I feel like you said Zelda is not that sort of experience where you're like sort of hunting around with other players and finding things with other players. It's more of a more solo explorative. You're out in the world by yourself, learning and exploring. Yeah. And so I feel like, yeah, like you said, it would just break the immersion for me personally.
Plus, Tingle Bottles made a lot of sense.
Oh, in game, like in the ocean like world, in-game, yeah,
it made sense. Like. How would you know, maybe it doesn't because we had never seen it before, but like a lot of us have seen movies and TV, the whole messages in a bottle thing. So while it wasn't such an original idea, it was still one of those like, okay, you could kind of see this.
Yeah, it worked in universe, but I think like in Breath of the Wild, you couldn't. There's not really. I can't think of an explanation that would work for leaving messages around the carved in a tree. I don't know.
Just with how much there is to explore in the. Demo area, I don't really. The game doesn't need it, I guess is one way to put it. I get trying to build like a sense of community around it, but.
I basically have the same thought as well. It doesn't really need it. If it's there, it's there, I guess. I was having an interesting conversation with another YouTuber by the name of Luke Crane. He pretty much brought the idea that. I believe I talked about this in a previous podcast, that Breath of the Wild is a very casual game in the sense you could play it, let's say go through a shrine and just. Put it down for a number of 15 minutes, and that whole mechanic can now actually revolve around, let's say, having the whole casual mood between Breath of the Wild. So it could have it, could not. Frankly, I'm not real. I won't lose any hair if it wasn't like. So if it's there, it doesn't really need it, in my opinion. But yeah.
Yeah. So there you go. We kind of got a little bit if it could help or hinder the game. It seems for the most part. None of us really feel it's going to be a big help to the game. And there's a little concern about hindering, not so much like holding the game back, but maybe be breaking a little bit of that immersion of playing by yourself, which this game clearly puts you, like thrusts you into that whole thing at the very beginning. So we'll see.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see. You know, we have don't, for all we know, there's an entire dungeon built around Miiverse.
Oh, boy.
We enter the interwebs.
So you have to play through the dungeon and work with the tips people have left behind for you to solve it. What happens to the first guy to ever enter that dungeon?
Right. Anyways. So we've got two more good fan topics. I am literally copying and pasting them into a document that I have now created today, saving these topics. So I don't just say we're going to get to them next time. We will this time. Because we got some stuff to talk about here. Not necessarily news, because there's been a lot of interesting news going on lately. Not necessarily so much for Nintendo, unless you want to talk about Super Mario Run. Which we're not really going to talk about that much. For those who don't know, Super Mario Run is a new mobile game Nintendo announced coming out later this year. It's free to start, and then there's a one-time payment after a certain amount to get the rest of the game.
Which is how
really
you
fun.
Should do free-to-play. It's the exact same model.
That's exactly. Well,
as the Picross 2.
What sort of like a free demo then?
Yeah.
See, I think there's different ways. Yeah. Free to play, I think there is like room in the market for games that charge you incremental amounts, kind of like Pokemon Go does. But this is not like that type of game. Like, this is, seems like it's a full game. Like a full game that they're going to let you try first. Mm-hmm. So it actually makes a lot of sense. I wish they would do this with all of their console games, actually.
Well, they should, because like, that's what convinced me to buy Pikmin 3, is I got the free demo, and then I loved it.
Think about for Breath of the Wild. It seems crazy, but just release that opening area as a demo, and literally have it so the player, when they download a demo, can only download that area, so they can't really see anything.
Do it now.
And then like, people could try the game and just do the demo area. And then if they want to get further, you got to buy the full $60 game.
I don't know. That's like the length of a full game, just that demo. So
that's the length of some indie games, not a Zelda game.
Okay, maybe not a Zelda game, but I haven't played it. You played it, so.
Yeah, there's a lot to see and do in just that demo area. So obviously, I didn't see and do all of it, but by now, I think over all the videos and post coverage I've seen of it, I think I've now seen everything there is to see in that area. That doesn't mean everything that's possible to do with the crazy physics engine has been done yet. But I'll be highly surprised if there's something I discover when I get the game or review a copy or I play it, you know, the day it comes out like the rest of you. If there's something there that I haven't seen, unless it's content that Nintendo pulled out of the demo. Well, there'll be weather effects as an example. We haven't seen that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Too.
If you guys want to hear about mobile games, we talked about that last podcast too.
Yep.
So yes, did, just yeah. just go listen to that one.
Yeah. It just so happened that a huge game, mobile game, got announced right after that.
Yeah.
That's just the way it goes.
Yep.
Just like now, we're gonna talk about. I got three topics here. I gotta get my timer going for this. We're gonna talk a little bit about the Wii U, because we're kind of reaching the end for the Wii U. We have confirmed, you know, titles for 3DS coming next year. So the 3DS at least has one more year. Rumors say it has two more years. Whatever the case may be, the 3DS still has at least another year to go. The Wii U is getting some games this year. It's getting Breath of the Wild technically next year. And it'll, who knows, it'll probably get the next Just Dance game next year or something too. But in all reality, the Wii U is essentially at the end of its life. And it's had an interesting path. A very different path than any other Nintendo console in the past has had. Even different than the Virtual Boy, because that was just an outright flop that died right away. The Wii U, you know, setting aside Virtual Boy, is the worst traditional home console that Nintendo has had in terms of sales. And when we're 5 years, 10 years down the road, how are you guys, because I know how I feel about this, and I want to let you guys kind of go on this topic a bit. How are you guys going to remember the Wii U? Like, what's it going to mean to you when someone says, hey, you remember that Wii U?
I actually think the price of Wii U's, the consoles online, like, let's say 20 years down the line, will actually increase. And the amount, like, let's say, Wii U's will be pretty valuable down the road, since it hasn't really sold that much in this generation. I think looking back at it, like, let's say 20 years from now, or let's say the next century happens in 2300 or something like that, people will actually look at the Wii U very fondly. For example, Smash Brothers for the Wii U 3DS, Super Mario 3D World. I love the soundtrack for that game, by the way. And there's so many others that people will probably look very fondly. Like, the thing is with the Wii U is that the gamepad wasn't really utilized to its maximum potential. Like, of course, there were games that utilized it, but there weren't really a whole lot that really brought it towards its fullest potential, in the sense that it could bring out new innovative gameplay like what Nintendo originally intended. And the fact that, like, when it was originally launched, there weren't really a whole lot of enticing launch titles. There was Zombie U and new Super Mario Bros. U, and that was really about it, unless I'm missing something. And the lack of marketing. And I remember a friend of mine, he was a manager over at GameStop, and he would always tell me, like, people were confused on what the difference was between the Wii U and the Wii, and that confusion may or may not probably has had a detrimental effect in terms of marketing the system in the first place. So looking back at it, I think it'll be a source of both comfort, but also a warning of not to repeat the same mistakes of the Wii U, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I agree. I feel like the Wii is the new Dreamcast. like it's a great system. Everyone who had a Dreamcast loved it. They always talked about how great the games on it were, but it like did not sell well enough to sustain. And like, well, Nintendo's not gonna like fold like fair. Sega did in the console market, but.
I do have to make one correction on that. To be fair, the Dreamcast, it was like, what was it, the month after the Dreamcast launch or something like that, is when Sega announced that they were getting out of consoles. Like, they had already been so far in debt from, like, the Sega CD and, like, launching new console, like, every 2 years, that the Dreamcast actually sold really well, but it was too late.
Yeah.
Well, there was other mistakes that led up to it. Yeah. I think it had a different lead-up, but I just mean in the way people... sort of will look back on it, like now.
Sure.
When people look back at the Dreamcast, like, ah, there's Soul Calibur and all these great games, and it was a great console that no one loved. And
Crazy Taxi.
Crazy Taxi.
And Skies of Arcadia.
And I think that's like how people will feel about the Wii U now. Like, I love my Wii U, but like Andy said, when it came out, I didn't know. I saw it in the store one day, and I was like, what is that? Is there a new console? I didn't even know. And, yeah, no, and then it took me years before... I didn't end up getting one until Smash and Mario Kart were announced. And then I was like, okay, I'm going to get one now. And then there was the Zelda trailers. And I was like, great, a new Zelda, probably later this year. it's worth the wait. But, I love my Wii. It's my favorite console of any console I've owned. And that's quite a few. But, like, I don't know... I know, like, two other people that have a Wii U. And one of them's my brother. So... yeah.
For me... I remember the first E3 that they showed off the Wii U. The very first E3. And we were just shown the controller. And I was with my friends, and we were all like, what the heck is that thing? And then they left the stage, and we still didn't know what the Wii U was. And that was their way of marketing it. And then they marketed it later on, quote unquote marketed, and then we have what we have now. And you know, there are some really good games on it, but the thing is I don't think, like, if you look at Sony and you look at Microsoft, you could kind of like pick out a few genres that they're like they always have on their console. Like, Sony typically has JRPGs, and they both have shooters, they both have first person shooters, they both have a bunch of different stuff. But there's like different things that they instantly, like, you think of, oh well, it's a Sony console, so it's going to have JRPGs on, Final Fantasy, or my mind's blanking on literally all the other possible JRPGs. But I look at the Wii U and like look at its crazy lifespan and see like all the different things, like the lack of direction that it has. And then I look at the games that are upcoming, and there's two things that I kind of want to, like, say about the Wii U. One of them is that the upcoming lineup is so bad for the rest of its lifespan. Like, it's just awful. Like, the popular Wii U games coming soon, according to IGN, are Paper Mario Color Splash, Just Dance, Exiles, and Shantae Half Genie Hero, which has been out so long already. Skylanders, yes, and Grand Prix Rockin' Racing. So those aren't like, oh man, those are some great triple A party games that we're getting from the Wii U. It's like, here's one Nintendo game, and then, you know,
we finally got Axiom Verge. way after everyone else.
Well, it's a Nintendo game that has a lot of proving to do too, because there's been a recent history of that particular franchise not doing well.
Yeah, and I look at that, and I also look at this past Direct, where they're like, oh, hey, you know how you love Yoshi's Woolly World? We're going to take that, and we're just going to throw it on the 3DS, but add more to it. So it's like, so what you're telling me is the 3DS, the new 3DS, can run a Wii U game. And that doesn't exactly inspire confidence with me with the console. And I think, I don't remember if you talked about it, McIntyre, or if Don talked about it last time, but someone said that the Nintendo hasn't been about like competing in the video game market with their consoles or with the power of their consoles. And they've talked about that in the past, how they're not here to compete. But that kind of shows in their success or lack of success, especially with the Wii U. Like, at what point does innovation trump, like, you know, power and technology and quality of a game? Because, you know, I look at the... I was playing... replaying Fire Emblem Path of Radiance. And the opening cutscene for that game was just as good as the cutscenes in Super Smash Bros. Brawl, and was just a little bit worse than the Wii U version cutscenes. So it's like, the power for the console really wasn't that great. I know it's not all about the power, it's about the exclusives and the games, but it's like, the Wii U, I'd say it's the worst console to date. It has great games on it, but it's still one of their worst. Like, just how it's done, just in general. I love it, but it's not their strongest console by far.
The Wii U is interesting for me, because for starters, it is the perfect console. Perfect console for me. They made a console that pretty much only appeals... Well, not only, but massively appeals to someone like me. And someone like me is a very rare person, especially at the time. As the years have gone on, I haven't really been that person anymore, but when I first got a Wii U, the only thing I cared about was off TV play. There was one TV in the whole house. I had children. There was no way in heck I was going to win a fight with them or my girlfriend for TV time. I was lucky I could watch Game of Thrones at the time, and that was only because I got my girlfriend into it. And now that we have multiple TVs in the house, like, she's not into it anymore. Surprise, surprise. But it's one of those that I don't need the off-TV feature anymore now, so now it doesn't really appeal to me as much. I don't think I've used the off-TV feature in 2 years now. But at the time, in that specific situation, it was the perfect console for me, because it let me play games, console games, home console games, not just 3DS, anywhere in my house.
I mean, technically, the 3DS is letting you do that now, so...
Yeah, and the thing is like you brought up, you know, oh, it's bringing over these games, and the thing is, Nintendo themselves has never really been, outside of a few select franchises they have, been making the kind of games that need a whole lot of processing power, a lot of GPU power. And a lot of that's just because the art direction their game's going. Mario Galaxy, if they just put it in HD... would look just as good as pretty much every modern game coming out on the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One, or now the PlayStation Pro coming out. Maybe not in 4K, but whatever. You get my point. The point is that the game wouldn't look dated compared to all those other games, because the art direction is at that point that it eliminates a lot of the extra visual fidelity that certain art styles and directions require.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at the Wii U's library, it's all of its like best-selling games are built of that kind of really stylistic art style. That's more, I don't want to say cartoony, but that's kind of the feeling I get from
it. It's more animated. It's not like realistic and grungy.
Well, like I'm just thinking back. You know, some of the most gorgeous games on the system are what? Mario 3D World, Mario Kart, Donkey Kong, Tropical Freeze. Splatoon looks really good.
I'd still say Tokyo Mirage Sessions.
Tokyo Mirage Sessions looks awesome, but again, Tokyo Mirage Sessions also, if you compare it to similar art styles on other consoles, does look dated.
Yeah.
So does Xenoblade Chronicles. Because those art styles can be done better. Those are the kind of art styles that do benefit from beefier hardware. They're not really the kind of things that Nintendo typically focuses on. And Zelda is kind of also one of those things that, outside of going in the direction of the Wind Waker, this is the kind of stuff that, like, Zelda needs to improve, like, their physics engine, improve the stuff they're doing with Breath of the Wild. They need more power. Like, that makes a big difference in a game like that. But Nintendo, in general, doesn't have a lot of popular franchises that need that kind of power to be successful, and I think that's why you can see, like, Yoshi's Woolly World coming to 3DS. It probably won't be the only Wii U game ported over.
Well, we also got Super Mario Maker, so
yeah, Super Mario Maker,
two in one go.
Yeah, and you know, speaking of Super Mario Maker, like, Super Mario Maker was, you know, supposedly the ultimate proving ground for why the gamepad matters, like what the innovation is with it. It didn't really prove to me that that's what the innovation of the console is. It just proved to me that that's the most obvious thing that should be happening, and why it doesn't happen in Minecraft on Wii U is beyond me.
I feel like it's not like cause, it's the opposite of cause and effect. Like, it's not that this is the most innovative way to use the gamepad, but more Super Mario Maker is like, that's the best way to make Super Mario Maker work.
Yeah. So it's just like, it would be like, if they would actually do it with Minecraft, it would be the best way to play Minecraft on the Wii U. Mm-hmm. They just won't do it because it's not worth the investment for them to do it.
And I think the problem with the Wii U and even inherently the Wii is that they were based around a single gameplay mechanic. And the Wii executed that very well within the first several years of its lifespan. Like, you saw a lot of games, you know, we got the motion control games, like, out everywhere now because it executed it. Well, you could say that it didn't execute it as well as could have, but it executed it pretty well. Like, we have games like, one of my personal favorites is Elebits. Love that game. Some people probably have no idea what it is. It was one of those proving games for the Wii and why it worked. But for the Wii U, like, its whole, like you said, the whole thing about it was the second screen. Like, that was what it focused on, was the Wii U gamepad. And when it was based around that whole thing, you know, it didn't really use it. It didn't really use it to its fullest. Like, I think the most interesting way I've seen it used is in Tokyo Mirage Sessions, as, like, the phone, the little phone pad in the map. But at the same time, you know, when you base it all around one singular gameplay mechanic, it's gonna fizzle out at some point. Like, that's,
of course,
that's just the way it's gonna happen. And so, you know, that's what you're not seeing with stuff like I hate that I keep comparing it, but with the PlayStation and with the Xboxes, they're not built around, like, oh well, to play the PlayStation you have to, like, stand upside down or, like, stand on your head and spin around like breakdance. It's, you have a controller and you play the game, and you could tilt the controller, you can move it around. And I think that, you know, that's one of the things about being very apprehensive about for the NX is, is it based around a singular gameplay mechanic? Is it based around, you know, the second screen? Is that going to be, like, the biggest selling feature of the game? That's another topic, but...
Yeah, I keep thinking, you know, what do I think of the Wii U today? Because I did a Boss Man episode a couple of months ago now, where I said that the Wii U is my favorite console because it has all the games I want to play on it. But a large percentage of those games are virtual console games.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm getting a lot of the games that I grew up with. Plus, I do think that it does have a stellar exclusive library. You know, anytime I can possibly bring it up, I will mention the Wonderful 101 is, like, one of the best games of this generation that literally no one has played. It's not easy to play, though.
It's not easy to play.
The thing is, it's already, like, in a niche genre with a niche game within that genre. Like, it's just not something that's going to appeal, especially on the surface, to a lot of people. But I just love it, and that's kind of the way I feel with a lot of the library. Now, 10, 20 years from now, I might look back and be like, oh, well, you know, I'm not really thinking much about those Wii U games anymore. I'm not thinking of Pikmin 3. I'm not thinking about Splatoon, outside of the fact that if Splatoon becomes a massive franchise, I'll know, okay, it started on Wii U.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of things that I'm not going to think about. It might almost be like the GameCube to me, where when I think back of the GameCube, I draw a blank a lot of times.
Oh, Nate, that hurts.
Don't say it.
But see, there's excellent games on the GameCube. There really is, and I know that. But it didn't leave a lasting impression with me like the N64 did, like the Super Nintendo did, NES did.
I think that's mostly a product of when, like, your generation too, though. Like, not, like, as in your generation is where you are, but, like, when you started gaming. So, like, I didn't really get...
Let's see, the Wii left an impression on me.
Yeah.
Like a positive impression. I know a lot of people are, oh, it's terrible, like... Actually, the Wii was brilliant. It made a lot of sense that you were talking about how, oh, you just pick up a controller and play on the PlayStation. They don't really focus on this big innovative stuff. Yeah, they're doing some VR, but it's kind of all an aside. That's not, like, what they're pushing as the main go-to for their platform. Well, Nintendo looked at it and said, look, that's great, but there's all these people that they pick up one of those controllers, and there's too many buttons. It's too foreign to them. The Wii made sense. It was simplistic. It had only the amount of buttons you needed to play Nintendo's games, and the motion controls just made sense.
Oh, but you're also, like, talking about the games that made a lasting impression, and you said that you couldn't really think of that for GameCube. And I look back at the Wii's life cycle, and just without thinking off the top of my head, there's only like two or three games that immediately snap into my head for it.
You're both killing me here.
Just off the top of my head, because the GameCube is possibly my favorite console of all time.
Sure.
And there are games that I really, really do like on the Wii U, and I'll probably remember those games more than on the Wii. And I don't know why. Yeah. I think the only game
on the Wii U that I'm going to remember for sure is Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze.
Good game.
To date, I personally feel it is the best 2D platformer I've ever played. And I've played a crap load of them, and so that's like a really bold statement. It's not like
it's one a that massively probably heard underrated before. Game.
But it, I mean, underrated. There's other people that think it's like the best 2D platformer ever as well. But it's man, in a very crowded genre, like it stands out to me.
I'd agree.
It's a good game. I like it
and
a lot.
And a lot of people wrote it off because, you know, oh, we just had Country Returns. Like, yeah, that's great, but...
Yeah, but you got
like,
Dixie
this
Kong.
This is way just, like, this is way better. Like, it took it to a whole new level. But it kind of fits my whole... Not so much necessarily the games. Like, maybe I was pushing it too far with saying the games because, honestly, you know, if you're someone right now, you're 12, 15, 16, 18, whatever, and you grew up with the Wii U the last 4 years... You are probably going to be really fond towards a lot of the games. I mean, mm-hmm. This might have been your first Smash Bros. Game you played. This might have been the first time you experienced Mario Kart.
I'm so sorry if it is.
Well, Mario Kart was good.
I know. I'm just saying, like, yeah. The classics, man. Like, Melee is still my favorite.
Yeah. I never understood the love for Melee, to be
different
honest.
Conversation. But just keep going.
But, of course, it's GameCube, so.
That's true. Master Race
Puzzle. But, no, so like... You know, I look back, because I keep thinking, I look back at stuff, you know, the GameCube is probably the system that I look down on the most in terms of not fulfilling what I thought it would fulfill for me at the time. And the thing is, I played a ton of, I played the crap out of the GameCube as I grew up. Like, I obviously had a good time. I just, when I look back on it now, it did feel as fulfilling to me. And I think with the Wii U, the problem I'm going to have with that, I'm going to look back on it and be like, hey, the Wii U was basically the console that Nintendo didn't know what the heck they were doing.
It feels like a beta test for the NX, if it's going to be.
I mean, we don't know what
the NX is. If the NX is what we're hearing that it's going to be, it's like, we tried it with the Wii U, what can we improve on to get the NX? That's
Which sounds like a totally terrible idea. To, you know our worst selling console? Let's just do that again.
But better.
Differently.
Yeah.
but no, like just think about it. Like, we talked a lot about the gamepad, you know, which very clearly Nintendo themselves didn't have a heck of a lot of good ideas for that gamepad that was supposed to be this big innovative thing, and it ended up not being that at all. In fact, the games that force the gamepad usage are usually the games that are liked the least because it doesn't feel as good as just a traditional control scheme did. It's not even like in Star Fox Zero. It's not that it's even terrible. It's just it's not as good. It's not as precise. It's not adding anything to the game that people are fundamentally enjoying with those motion controls. That's why a lot of people that play Star Fox Zero end up trying to ignore the motion controls as much as they can because it doesn't feel good. And that's what they kind of lost with the gamepad is outside of the very obvious uses like in Super Mario Maker or putting your inventory on the screen, that stuff felt right because, hey, you have an extra screen, so why not? But it didn't really feel like it added anything to those games. Maybe Zombie U probably had the best usage of the gamepad where it actually made it fundamental to the game and it added suspense to a game by like removing like your view from the screen to try to hack a door on your gamepad actually added suspense to that game. But again, that's like Ubisoft, not Nintendo, and Nintendo seemed really dry with ideas. And it's not just that, they have the TV button on there, which I'm sure most people who own a Wii U totally ignore it even exists.
It's really handy.
Hey, I use it. I use
really
it.
Handy, yeah.
I use it too, but like, but how many people are like, man, I gotta get this thing because it's got a TV remote?
Or, I think that's...
Like, it launched with like the Nintendo TV like program that was supposed to be with it. And that thing totally bombed out and was terrible from the get-go because the system was actually not even powerful enough to do what they wanted to do with it. Because the number one issue with Nintendo TV, besides being almost entirely pointless, since you're not running a pass... Like, it would sound like a good idea on the Xbox One that has a TV pass-through.
Yeah.
So like, you combine your Netflix and your TV together. That sounds like a brilliant idea for, like, Xbox. Don't know why they haven't done it. But Nintendo had that idea, and it could have did something with it, especially with all the streaming services. And instead, because their system was so weak, it was so slow to navigate, it was quicker to just find it on my phone and just flip it up to my TV through, you know, a stick plugged into the back.
And I think,
or just to use the smart TV features itself instead of the Wii U gamepad.
I think that's, you know, like what we were talking about earlier, while Nintendo doesn't need to, like, well, Nintendo does need to compete in some areas, I think that's one of the areas that we saw them compete in and ultimately fail. Because that was when, you know, we had the Xbox, like you said, was trying to be an all-in-one console. Like, not only is it just a gaming console, but it's also, you know, it runs PC-type programs on it. You can use your TV. And then even the PS4 now, they're having the PlayStation television service with like over 1,000 channels or whatever it is. And so
it's actually a really good deal, too.
It is. Whenever I get a PS4, I'm probably going to end up doing that. But Nintendo, that's like you said, it wasn't powerful enough, and that's not really where they needed to put their focus on. Like, I understand wanting to control the TV with that, and that was like kind of handy sometimes, but ultimately it was a lot simpler just to change the remote, like pick up the physical remote control, or even just walk over to the TV and press the input button.
I don't know. I found that I used it because it was way more convenient than having to put the gamepad down and then grab the remote and
sometimes.
Well, it's also depending on how you're using it, of course. Like, the TV remote functionality was fine. It didn't work very well with my cable box, but...
That's true, yeah.
Whatever, that has to do with whatever Nintendo's deciding to support. But, like, the Nintendo TV app itself, to me, was just totally useless. If I want to watch TV, I'm not using my Wii U.
I actually did not use it a single time, so...
I really tried hard using it that first Super Bowl that they had it up for, because they were doing, like, these quizzes and these questions throughout, and, like... You were competing against other people, and it would be so slow that by the time I'm hitting submit on it, it wouldn't go through because the app was lagging so bad. Then I would suddenly not get my answer in for that question, and I suddenly missed the next four. That might be server capacity too, with how many people are trying to access it. But reality was is that they had all these ideas, none of them were fully fleshed out. None of them seemed like they were even tested. And none of it really kind of went through anyone that actually handles these programs, like handles TV stuff. Like, people in the TV industry weren't really consulted on it. The developers at Nintendo didn't seem to even be consulted on the gamepad idea, like, because they clearly ignored it for years. Most of the library on Wii U from Nintendo does not require a gamepad, because it's not really something the developers seem to even want to use.
Well, even speaking of Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze, you could turn off the gamepad. Yeah. Screen, so it's not even necessary in games like
that. I mean, it's just one of those things where it felt like the upper execs, like, you know, Miyamoto, Iwata, and others at the time, had these ideas but didn't run them by anyone, and then just said, we're doing them anyways because we were right with the Wii. And it's like, yeah, but the Wii, you almost have to run by developers because, hey, you're not going to have a zillion buttons anymore. You're doing motion controls. Oh, hey, we're going to give you a traditional controller, but that's basically the only part of this you're going to like. That's what felt weird about it. It wasn't that third parties didn't like it. Like, you could see that coming a mile away unless it blew up and got really popular.
Yeah.
Because even the Wii, you know, yeah, it didn't get some games, but it did get a lot more. I mean, there was Call of Duty coming out every single year on Wii.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was a popular platform, and Call of Duty itself would sell at least 1 million copies every year, which made it worthwhile. Plus, I'd argue that the controls were actually superior on the Wii, but that's a debate for another time on if the motion control was better than the traditional controller.
Well, and the benefits using a Nintendo console for a game like that, especially now, is that you don't have to pay for online. And I really hope that that's something that Nintendo does with the NX, because then they'll have if they can make a console... That's like powerful enough to do that.
Nintendo's at a point they cannot charge for online.
Yeah. Well, their online hasn't been good enough up to this point anyway.
Well, it can't. Like, Xbox did it right away, basically. They've always charged. And they offered a really, really good service. Like, it was the first truly, fully functioning online service for a platform, for a home console that was popular.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, they've always been able to charge. Sony wasn't charging when they first started getting to do it. Now they do, and their network is up to snuff. Like, I'm not saying Nintendo can't ever charge, but they have a long ways to go before they can get to that point and where their consumers see it as a value. Yeah. Right now, their online is nice. It's free. There's a lot of issues with it. Why the heck we still even have friend codes around? Why the heck is it really hard to search up buddies that you want to add to your friends list?
And it uses really weird ports and, like, servers to get
through really
the
weird
internet.
Stuff. So it seems like the internet connections are almost limited when, like, at my house, not because of your servers. Like, it's just really weird. So there's a lot of things they have to do with that. I also, you know, we keep bringing up the NX a little bit, so I'm just going to quickly get into this one topic I really wanted to get into. We'll see how much time we have to talk about it. So we've talked about the NX learning from the Wii U and all that great stuff. What the heck is up with the lack of NX info? We've made fun of in the past that an announcement for an announcement is really silly, really stupid. Except when it's an announcement for when you're going to talk about your brand new system.
Mm-hmm.
It's supposedly coming out in 6 months. Like 6 months from today, at some point, it's coming out. And we don't even know when they're going to announce it. Now, they have like this GameStop event coming up where they're on Wednesday, but they're not going to talk about it there.
No.
That's not going to be there. If it was going to be there, they'd be hyping it already, like live streaming and all that stuff. So I guess I'm really frustrated at this point, which maybe I shouldn't be, but when have we ever been like this close to a launch and we still don't know what this thing is? All we know is rumors. All we know are various reports out there. You know, supposedly, like, there's been a new software development kit. There's a new rumor, I think, that just came out today. The new SDK just is, like, getting primed to release, which might be the final one before release. I guess I am just really frustrated with the lack of info, and I don't know if I should be. Like, should I be frustrated? Like, should fans out there just be like, man, what the hell is Nintendo doing?
I feel like part of what they're doing is they're, like, keeping us in the dark to keep us sort of guessing, keep us talking about it, keeping it a popular subject, because like we always know there's gonna be a new console like every 5 or 4 or 6 years, however long. But like this is the first time, at least that I've noticed, that like people have been talking about it this much. And maybe it's because I'm listening more, but I feel like it's them sort of keeping us guessing, you know?
Yeah, but we're talking because of leaks, supposed leaks.
Yeah.
We're not talking because of Nintendo. Nintendo's not creating any of this.
Well, Andy,
what do you have to
maybe
say?
Not.
You've been quiet.
I personally have a particular theory on why there's so much little information in terms of the NX. I guess the best point in terms of a reference date and when to try to figure out why Nintendo's been so fixated is that if you take a look at the Japanese yen, when the Wii U was released, the value of the yen was at an absolute low. I had to look up the exact numbers for it, but it was pretty low. Even Kimishima actually stated in a separate interview that the value of the yen being low actually contributed to how Nintendo actually funded marketing for the Wii U and such. And he would actually, and due to that, he doesn't want the NX to be sold at a loss. He basically said those words in some shape or form. So how does this like tie into other statements said by, let's say, Reggie Fils-Aimé and Shigeru Miyamoto and Eiji Onuma? Basically, Reggie Fils-Aimé, I believe he said in a separate interview, I think it was the New York Times, I think, but like they said they don't want to compete against Microsoft and Sony and they want to do their own thing, pretty much. Which both of those statements kind of fit hand in hand. Kimishima says he doesn't want the NX to be sold at a loss, and Reggie Fils-Aimé says he doesn't want to be all about the horsepower and the gigaflops. Which kind of just goes hand in hand. And then there was an excellent tweet by, I believe, Emily Rogers. Like I know there's very controversial thoughts about what Emily Rogers does, but she did make a very interesting statement in a Twitter post saying that Nintendo doesn't really like E3s lately. More often than not, Nintendo gets a lot of negative feedback at E3. Save for this one, since Breath of the Wild pretty much just broke the internet.
Yeah, it's like the most surprisingly brilliant move anyone's ever done in E3 history, I swear.
Right.
Like, who knew? Who knew? I don't even think Nintendo knew.
Yeah, in all honesty, like, I actually sat and watched, like, all 6 hours of the live stream, and then I was like, what am I doing with my day? I can't believe I'm this absorbed into this, like, more than I've ever been on an E3 presentation on anything ever.
It's one of the few, I think it's one of the few times at E3 I was talking to people who go there every year that... I think they said it was the only time that a line to get into a booth was closed down within 5 minutes of the show floor opening. Like, they would not let anyone else get in line.
Wow.
Because that's how long the line was. Like, the waits were 4+ hours.
Ooh. Yeah.
Like that's crazy. Nintendo knew that, they probably would have even set up even more kiosks, and they already had 170 of them. Which was way more than, like, every other booth there. In total. But yeah.
And so,
sorry, go on.
No worries. So basically, in terms of, let's say, the NX not necessarily competing against Sony or Microsoft being its own thing, Kimishima also said that I'm already assuming you guys already know this. I think you already stated this, that they're not going to go by the Wii moniker anymore. They're leaving behind the whole Wii branding behind. Yeah. So from this, we can make, I suppose, a couple of inferences. One thing, if they're going by a brand new branding altogether, there's going to be a massive media campaign. Since if you're not going behind a previous brand, you need to market a new brand. Whatever this brand is, I have no idea. But we can make a healthy assumption that they will market it to the extreme.
And it'll be red themed.
Definitely.
That is one marketing change they have made. Without talking about the NX yet, because they went back to red after the Wii started the blue thing.
Right. And so basically, keeping that in mind and seeing that the NX will not be sold at a loss, I have a mind that Nintendo wants to pull off some sort of a media stunt in the sense of getting like a lot of media coverage at a very efficient way without having to, let's say, fork over their own funds to actually do, let's say, warm marketing, which means like commercials and stuff like that. But in order to have the internet work for them, to have the NX be splattered out everywhere. Because right now, people are starving for NX news, and that's exactly what Nintendo wants. They want us to be starved. They want us to be, like, thirsty for new news. And so basically, once we're at the point of, like, let's say, no return, and we actually want to learn so much NX news, and that we're getting to the point that we just don't care anymore, Nintendo will probably showcase the NX. There's a couple of rumors that the NX will be revealed tomorrow. I'm not sure if that's the case or not. There's a bunch of rumors going on nowadays, but
it would be Nintendo to not even announce they're going to announce it, and then they're like, here's the NX. Glad you didn't pay attention to that announcement. Have a good day.
Yeah.
It's weird to me because. I know that Nintendo says, you know, how much they don't care about Sony and Microsoft. Like, they're not trying to compete with them. But in order for them to win the internet, those are the people that are going to help you win the internet. They're going to, like, when Zelda was destroying at E3, it wasn't just Nintendo fans. That was gamers. Like, serious core gamers that are on other platforms. When I was in line, there were people that worked at Sony waiting in the line to go play Breath of the Wild. Like, this is what that's the kind of hype that just that one title was generating, and I think that's the kind of hype they want the NX to generate, because that's what's going to make it sell well. And
so do you think
they're in the conundrum where the internet, you're only going to win it if you appeal to the people that use the internet, and the people who use it are the gamers. They're the ones that are going to make it trend on Twitter. They're the ones that are going to make it be over everyone's Facebook walls. Because the people that are like the soccer moms that got into Wii, they weren't sitting there on Facebook at the time, because Facebook was around then. They weren't sitting on Facebook typing up, oh man, did you hear about the Wii? They didn't know what that thing was until they saw someone use it in person. So like, if they're going after a more broader crowd like that, they're not going to win the internet. Now, if they're trying to go after gamers, they can win the internet. And I think the problem with winning the internet, which is clearly, I think what they saw with Breath, I think what goes into what you're saying there a little bit is they saw what happened with Breath of the Wild. It's still like trending on the internet right now, and that's what the kind of reaction they want to NX. And so, waiting for the right time to do that. The problem I have is that from this point through the end of the year, there really isn't a right time to do that anymore, because all the big games are now coming out. All the big announcements are now coming out. Like, we just had the PlayStation Pro announced, and now that's going to be releasing, and that's going to be hyped, and there's going to be a lot of conversations around that. I don't know how hyped that's going to be. It's already pretty hyped along on the Sony crowd.
Yeah, but it was kind of a disappointment, though.
What is
too.
It? When it was announced, it was trending on Twitter. Now, obviously, this did not last as long as Breath of the Wild did, so it didn't blow up like Breath of the Wild did. But the point is, like, it's just more big news coming out that's going to be distracting people who would otherwise only care about, like, oh man, we're starved for NX info. Now we got it. We got to share it with everyone. Well, they might not care. Like, oh, the NX came out. That's great. I just bought Call of Duty last night. I don't have time to go talk about that. I'm playing Call of Duty with my buds. I'm playing Titanfall 2. I'm playing Battlefield 1. I'm playing, you know, whatever big game's coming out.
See,
The Last Guardian's coming out now in December whatever. Like, if it doesn't get delayed again. So it's kind of one of those, like, we're hitting the point where now we're to the point where all people want to play, all they want to talk about are games. Like, they just want to play games. So, like, having a console announcement in the midst of all these big games coming out, especially if you're not getting any pledges of support for those kind of big games coming to your platform in the future, is already going to make people be like, okay, NX is coming up, but all these great games I want to play right now, that platform's never going to get games like that, so we don't care.
I think my...
So then you're left with Nintendo fans, like us, trying to make everyone care. And I don't think that's going to work.
I think that it was Kimishima that said that part of the reason they delayed the NX was so that they could have a good launch lineup.
Yeah, yeah, that's why it's delayed to next year. Okay, it wasn't ever announced for to release in 2016, so it technically wasn't publicly delayed. But he definitely made it sound like there was internal delay to make sure that they had more content. And but see, like, that's them making content. Like,
yeah, but that strikes me as learning from the Wii U's mistake, because, like, someone said earlier in this very podcast that when the Wii U came out, there was nothing to play on it except for Super
Mario
Bros.
Well, that's them learning. Let's suppose this is, like, the hybrid thing they've been talking about. That already shows they learned from the 3DS and Wii U that if they are going to be the only people making games to the platform, that they cannot support two platforms on their own. There's going to be huge gaps in content. Because it wasn't, like, everyone forgets that the 3DS started off just like the Wii U. Actually, worse. Because at least the Wii U had Zombie U and New Super Mario Brothers. Like, the 3DS had, what, Pilot Wings, Street Fighter 4,
which... Whatever the battleship game was.
Yeah.
Steel Diver.
Like, Steel Diver. It had nothing. Nothing that anyone cared about. People bought it because they wanted to see the 3D with no glasses. But then they stopped. Like, it had a really, like, record, like, launch weekend sales, and then people just stopped buying it because there was nothing to play.
And it continued
that way until the price cut, and then they had, you know, Mario Kart, and then they started getting some titles out for it. And then and then once that happened, third-party support started coming in a little bit, Bravely Default and games like that. So, like, it has third-party support now. But reality is that the Wii U and 3DS both started out with, like, 9 months of no games. Like, it launched, here's a couple games, and they might be good or they might not, but we'll see you next Christmas. Like, not even this year's Christmas, next year's Christmas. We'll see you then. It's kind of like the only way they can prevent that is having all their games on one platform or somehow, some way, convincing third parties to come on board. And obviously, we've heard good things from third parties so far, but it doesn't really mean anything until they actually announce a game. Like, Bethesda has come out openly and said, hey, we like what we're hearing. We haven't ruled out the NX. Obviously, we've ruled it out for Dishonored 2, but that's because Dishonored 2 is almost done, so it just doesn't make sense, but it doesn't mean we can't do future games on it. And it's kind of like, yeah, but all of these companies are all saying the same thing. They're beating the exact drum that Nintendo doesn't beat, and that's if it has enough power, we'll support it.
I think the problem with, like, going back to how long they're taking for it, how long they're waiting to announce it, is it's kind of like the same thing with The Last Guardian, is that sure. People have known that it's going to come out for a while. Like, we've known about The Last Guardian for, like, a decade.
Yep.
And I've said this before, so many people have said this before, there's no possible way on God's green earth that game's going to live up to the expectations and hype that
well,
it has.
Well, here's the thing about that game. And this is even, like, because I'm on the GAF, I'm on all these various websites. It's losing hype.
It is.
Not gaining.
Well, it doesn't
gaining
look
hype.
As good as you would think. Like, a lot of people say it doesn't look as good as it should.
Yeah. And it's not even that. They're like, not showing anything that they didn't show back in 2009.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, like, brief extensions of what we've already seen 6-7 years ago. Like, okay, can we see what makes this game great, right? Like, what about this game makes it great? What makes it stand out? We haven't seen it. So, like, people are like, man, is this game just not that great? Because they don't have nothing to show. Now, yeah. They're hoping that the Tokyo Game Show ends up, you know, being the big blowout for it, because that's really the last big show of the year for that game to get a shot to do that. But the NX can't be doing something like that, man. Like, I know it worked for Breath of the Wild, right? But, like, it worked because when they showed Breath of the Wild again, they totally did a huge, massive blowout. Like, we knew so little about Breath of the Wild before this past E3. And that was just, like, a 2-year wait.
Well, also, they did a blowout. It was like, well-timed. Like, it was at a time where we were listening, you know, when we were ready for this information intake.
It was also at a time when they didn't have anything else to talk about.
Well, that's quality over quantity, I guess.
Well, like I'm just looking at the NX and what's coming out, and we've talked about this before on this podcast too. Is like all this information's coming out that's not confirmed, but this is what we're all expecting for the console, and that's not necessarily good, because if this is the image that they're like, if they don't want to paint this image, if this isn't at all what the console's supposed to be, then right now we all have the wrong image of the console in our mind, and that's not good. They need to get ahead of this, and it's a little it's getting really really late for them to do this. Like people are expecting. Emily Rogers posted a poll on her Twitter about when do you think they'll announce the NX, and a bunch of people said this week, but majority of the votes were for early October, and that's kind of what it's looking like right now, and that's not good because
if she had done that poll 3 weeks ago, they would have said early September.
I know, and it's just like we're imagining it later and later, and I guess the problem is, like you said, the console's coming out very very soon, and we don't know anything about it except that. You know,
and we're entering a period where people are about to spend a bunch of money on games.
Yeah, I need to know how much money to save.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, if people are like, oh, I'll wait on Call of Duty, I'll wait on this stuff till the price drop, and I'll set aside that $60 for the NX. Well, they're not going to do that if they don't even know what it is. And if it's totally different than what's being put out there by media outlets, which, yeah, it might make the media outlets look silly, but it also makes Nintendo look stupid, too. Unless they're doing something that literally is going to blow people's minds. That's totally unexpected and ends up getting people hyped. And, like, you know, do we think Nintendo could even possibly pull that off? That they even know how to pull that off anymore? Because even at E3, Breath of the Wild's reaction almost seemed like an accident. Like, they didn't know it was going to get that big. They would have did something totally different with their booth if they had known it was going to be that big. They would have fixed the... I mean, their live stream for Breath of the Wild was crashing because of all the people trying to get in just to see what this game... Like, they had no idea it was going to be that way. So, like, now we got to think, okay, so now Nintendo wants to intentionally do that. I don't know if they can.
And one of the things that it seems like they're doing, and I could... This would be so Nintendo to do, would be to pull a Fallout 4 and be like, oh, hey, like, in December or, like, January, like, hey, you know that console that we've been talking about? Well, here it is. Here's the NX. You can go buy it in 3 months. And the reason why that worked for Fallout 4 is because we had no idea that was coming.
Plus, it's a game.
Yeah.
It's a difference between a game announcement a few months before release than a platform that costs hundreds of dollars.
No, I know. And that's the thing is, I think they're like, oh, we're just going to surprise everyone with this because they're never going to see it coming. It's like, well, we don't want to be surprised with a game console announcement, especially when we've heard about for 2 years.
Yeah, the difference is, like, yeah, Fallout 4, there was a lot of suspicion that it was being made, but there was nothing from the company that indicated necessarily that they were going to be releasing Fallout 4 now. NX is different. They gave us a release, like, month before they even announced what the dang thing is. Like, when does that happen? Why do we know when this console is coming out before we even know what the thing is?
Because Nintendo.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Like, well, I guess I have a hard time believing that they're going to somehow be able to blow everyone's minds when they still seem a little bit out of touch by even telling people when this thing is coming before they even tell anyone what it is.
And I think you hit the nail on the head, too, when you talked about, you know, the PlayStation Pro is coming out. And then sometime, like, Q1... 2017, you got the Xbox Scorpio, whatever that is.
It might end up getting pushed back to holiday.
That's true.
Either way. It's coming out next year.
We're hearing, like, it's going to be sandwiched in between these two super powerful consoles, and, you know, I'm not leaning towards buying either of them, but I know that there are people that are, and there are people that are looking at these things and like, oh man, the PS4 Pro looks greater. I can't wait to see what Xbox is doing. And they already have a kind of
because they've had announcements.
Yeah,
they've had announcements for it. And so it wasn't just it exists. It's called it's codenamed NX. We don't know why it's codenamed NX because the guy who named it that is dead. Thank you. It'll be releasing next year. What? Okay. Like, what kind of marketing is that? Like, they repeat it. Even like the 3DS direct they recently did, which happened to have Wii U news in it, so like Anyways, they could have just, it might as well have just been a regular direct. But, like, they have to mention, we will not talk about NX in this thing. I'm like, why even say the words NX? Mm-hmm. Like, just pretend it doesn't exist until you want to announce it.
Okay. It's conspiracy theory.
Keep bringing it up to, like, remind people that it exists, essentially. But then to remind them also that you're not really going to tell them anything about
it. Well, you know what that reminds me of? And I might be the only one, and, you know, there might get some comments about this. I don't know if you care. But back when I was, like, a kid in church, and you were having prayer requests, there would always be that kid that was like, oh, but I have this unspoken one that you're not supposed to know. don't tell anyone. But, like, I have something that you can't know about, but I need you to, like, I need you to be praying for. Don't ask, because I can't tell you. And I feel like that's what Nintendo's doing. Like, don't ask about this, because we can't tell you right now, but it's going to be good. But just, yeah. You know, don't worry
about it. I wonder, the only thing I could think of is because Nintendo has openly talked in the past, especially the late Satoru Iwata, talked a lot about how much they like the way that Apple approaches their ecosystem and all that, yada, yada, yada. The only thing I could think of is them trying to pull an Apple, where they announce it like 2 weeks before it releases.
No headphone jack.
Oh, jeez. Okay, my conspiracy theory is that
Iwata had all the... It doesn't...
He had all the NX plans, and he took them to the grave with him, and they have to make a new console. So,
well, yeah. See, we also know that that's not... I mean, I want to believe that that's what happened, and that's why we're getting all these weird delays with it, but...
No, I'm just BSing.
But, like, we do know, like, he talked to... Like, apparently he had a lot of detailed plans for how to proceed with the NX and with everything else at the company. So, like... that's what feels weird about this, because if Iwata was still around, this thing would have been unveiled at E3.
Yep.
Because that's just what he does. We've been through Iwata console cycles. He would have announced it at E3. He probably would have said it's coming out in 2016, and it probably would have released in 2016 with no games.
Yeah.
It might have had Breath of the Wild if they could have got it done in time, and then it would have had nothing for until summer next year.
And I think that might like show us what the difficulty is here, because if it was up to Kimishima, they probably wouldn't have announced it so early.
Yeah, and that's true. And I understood why the announcement was made, but it was such a weird... It was even weirder than, like, yeah, we're going to the mobile games. By the way, we're still going to be making home consoles. It's like, you could just let people be afraid and then announce a home console when you're ready. Like, that's how you instill confidence that you're not getting another home console game. Like, keep making games and then announce the home console when it's ready to be announced. Or portable, or whatever this thing ends up being. And what I find really weird about all this is that they're supporting the 3DS for, like, another couple of years, yet they're releasing a handheld?
Well, we think. That's what we think.
That's what we think. Well, no, we know for sure it's being supported through 2017.
No.
That's
what this we think that the console is going to be a handheld.
Yeah, that's what we think. Now, there was a very old rumor that there's multiple SKUs, that there's a handheld, and there's actually a separate home console, and it could be that the handheld, like, releases early next year than the home console releases in the holiday.
Yeah.
And that could still be a thing, and that would definitely be surprising compared to the report on the hybrid. Like, yeah, it could just be you can play that on there, and they will share libraries, but there actually will be a separate home console system. Maybe that's getting to the realm of what I want more so than what reality is going to end up being. But again, Nintendo won't tell us anything. And this is my whole frustration with it. It's not just that we don't know anything. It's we know enough from either people who have dev units or have SDKs or assuming that they have like the real deal and these are legit sources, which it seems we have enough like pretty reputable reporters out there now to kind of say some of this stuff has to be real. And then we also know from Nintendo when the dang thing's releasing. So why can't we know when you plan to I used the example before that, you know, maybe they're trying to pull an Apple and they announce it 2 weeks before it comes out. But we know when Apple's going to announce it.
Yeah.
Like they let you know months in advance, like, hey, look, we're having a press conference. Here's so-and-so. We're going to talk about our next generation iPhone, our next generation this. You know, yada, yada. Like, we know what's coming, and we know when they're going to do it a long time ahead of time. At this point...
Yeah, it's around the same time that your iPhone stops working.
At this point, the last thing we heard about NX is they said at E3 that they will announce it and release more information on it this year. Well, we have 3 months to go. It's about time we know when you're going to announce it.
Sorry to interject, just to give like a few points on the NX. I believe how the name NX came apart is that it was called a Nintendo Cross, or at least we translate it as a Nintendo Cross here in the States. Then somebody called it NX, and it went back to Japan, and then it was like, oh, NX. Even Kimishima was kind of confused about the name NX.
Yeah, he said that he does not know what it stands for.
Yeah.
Like, that's one thing that, like, Iwata never told him. Like, what does it stand for? Because apparently, supposedly, the way that he framed it is it doesn't seem relevant necessarily to what the system is. It's just random to him.
Yeah. Well, on another note, I'm actually going to have to leave right now,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah. That's okay. Cool. No, that's fine. Actually, we're gonna wrap things up. I know, like, I knew this topic was going to go way over because I'm very passionate about my distaste for what Nintendo's doing with the NX so far. I'm hoping that whenever they show it, it's worth it. Better be worth it, Nintendo. Please be worth it. I really want it to be good. Like, I want your system, man. I don't want to have to rebuy a Wii U to play Breath of the Wild because I don't want an NX. All right. Well, that's going to do it for this week's podcast. Obviously, my first week back, I had a feeling it was going to go over because I wanted to talk about this topic last week, but I wasn't here. I want to thank McIntyre for sticking it out a little longer than planned. Thank Daniel for popping in kind of in the last hour or so when I was gathering some people to do this.
Thanks.
And obviously, I want to thank Alfred for running things last week and shuffling his schedule around to make our brand new recording time. For those who don't know, we don't normally record on Tuesdays. So, like, if there's a bunch of NX news that hits, like, on Tuesday or whatever, and we're talking about the stuff after the fact, well, sorry. We record on Mondays now. We release on Wednesdays. There's a potential of some, like, Patreon support in the future that might get you the podcast on Tuesday, so then it doesn't sound so far behind. But, like, an audio version of it. But that's a discussion for another time. Thanks for joining the Zelda Informer podcast, everyone. Stay awesome.
Stay frosty.
See you guys.
Stay frosty.
Thanks again. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.